Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents Haig's Enemy, Crown Prince Rupprecht and Germany's War on the Western Front, by Jonathan Boff, narrated by Julian Elfer. Introduction. Crown Prince Rupprecht of Bavaria first came alive for me a few years ago. I was working on a book about the last few months of the war on the Western Front and had gone to Munich to explore the archives of the Bavarian army. These somehow escaped the Second World War firebombs which destroyed many of the Prussian records and, as a result, constitute one of the best sources for information on the German army during the First World War. On the last day of my trip, as I was idly flicking through a folder of apparently random documents, one sheet of paper caught my eye. It was a passport issued by the Dutch embassy in German-occupied Brussels, allowing the Marquis de Villalobar and his party to enter the Netherlands on the 12th of November 1918. What was it doing in the personal files of Crown Prince Rupprecht of Bavaria? I already knew a little about Rupprecht. I knew, for instance, that he served as one of Germany's most senior generals between 1914 and 1918 and spent most of the war fighting against the Tommies of the British Expeditionary Force, BEF, leading the German 6th Army and later an army group of 1.5 million men in famous battles such as Ypres, the Somme and Passchendaele. It was Rupprecht's men who launched Germany's last gasp offensives in March 1918, and when they failed, it was his army group that felt much of the weight of Allied counterattacks during the so-called 100 Days campaign in August to November 1918. Rupprecht's closest British counterpart and most consistent enemy was probably Sir Douglas Haig. Like Rupprecht, Haig rose to command an army group, the BEF, and everywhere Haig and the BEF turned from October 1914 on, Rupprecht and his men were in the way. A good parallel from the Second World War might be the mythical rivalry between Bernard Montgomery and Erwin Rommel, although Haig and Rupprecht, who never met and were in no sense personal rivals, would have despised any propaganda of personality of that kind. What did the Marquis de Villalobar have to do with Rupprecht, though, and why was he travelling to neutral Holland the day after the armistice had been signed? In the early days of November 1918, Germany was in double crisis. At home, socialist agitators were whipping up revolution, pushing crowned heads from their thrones and seizing power. Among those deposed were Kaiser Wilhelm II and Rupprecht's father, King Ludwig III of Bavaria. At the front, the famed discipline of the German army was breaking down after a series of heavy battlefield defeats. Some units were already setting up Russian-style soldiers' councils, Soviets. The people of Brussels, where Rupprecht had his headquarters, cowered behind locked doors as gangs of drunken German soldiers rampaged through the streets, looting and worse wherever they could. Rupprecht's life might be in danger. Less than 4 months before, after all, Bolsheviks had pitilessly murdered the Russian Tsar and his entire family. The Spanish ambassador to Belgium, Rodrigo Marques de Villalobar, came to Rupprecht's rescue. He offered sanctuary in the embassy and made arrangements to smuggle him, disguised as plain Mr. Landsberg, to safety in the Netherlands. That was what the passport was for, and that explained why it had found its way to the archive in Munich. Answering one question, however, raised others. How was the proud heir to an ancient throne, a man of consequence in Germany and across Europe, a field marshal who had led hundreds of thousands of men in battle, reduced to skulking across borders under cover of darkness and a false name? This is the first question this book seeks to answer. It offers the first biography of Crown Prince Rupprecht in English, concentrating on his military career. He has had several German biographers, but they have tended not to be specialists in the history of warfare. Only a couple of scholarly articles in German have addressed this aspect of his career before now. As we will see, the human story is a fascinating, moving, and possibly tragic one. It also, however, raises important questions with broader ramifications than the purely individual. Studying Rupprecht's military career allows us to interrogate and challenge several of the preconceptions we have about the First World War and about modernity itself. We can, for instance, see the war from a new perspective if we look through Rupprecht's eyes. Too often we have been told the story of the Western Front from the British point of view alone. The French and even the Germans often fade into the background or even out of the picture altogether. This book aims to help correct this distortion and to give the proper weight to all three armies, enabling us to understand the war in a more balanced way. We can also explore important questions about the war. One of the key ones is, why did Germany lose the First World War? Inevitably, a range of factors played a part. Germany did not lose the First World War only because her army was defeated on the Western Front. Events on other fronts and at home, some of which had little or nothing to do with Rupprecht, played a part in determining the outcome. So there are limits to what studying him can tell us. For instance, his contribution to grand strategy, the level of war where politicians set overall aims and allocate resources, was, as we shall see, limited. He did, however, know all the key decision-makers and was extremely well-informed. Consequently, he is a useful source of information about the direction of the war. We will see that the German leadership made strategic mistakes at every stage. Few historians would disagree with that. The more interesting question is why. Rupprecht himself spent the war fighting on the Western Front, working at the operational level of war. This is where generals construct and fight campaigns, design and sequence battles, allocate resources and manage reserves to achieve the mission they have been set by the strategists. Below the level of operations lies that of tactics, where soldiers fight their battles. Get the tactics right and you win battles. Get the operational art right and you win campaigns. Get the strategy right too and you win wars. The Western Front was one campaign of a larger war, and for both sides winning there was necessary, even if it was not sufficient for victory. Control of France and Belgium was precisely what many thought they were fighting for in the first place, and it was here that both sides deployed their most powerful forces. The focus of this book, therefore, is on the operational level of war on the Western Front, where seeing events through Rupprecht's eyes can be very helpful. This is an aspect of Germany's war which historians have tended to neglect, concentrating instead either on the view of the supreme commander or of the individual soldier in the trench. Germany has even less of a tradition of operational military history than British academia. In neither English nor German has any historian yet followed a single senior German general and the formations he commanded through the whole war, as this book does. Doing so shows how the German military reacted to the stresses of conflict and the need for rapid and sometimes radical change. Many military historians tend to assume that the German army of the first half of the 20th century was highly skilled, tactically, largely because it operated a flexible system of command known as Auftragstaktik, mission command, which delegated authority and ensured that the man best placed to make any decision was the one issuing the orders. Other strengths included high levels of training and motivation. However misguided or downright evil the purposes to which the army was put, they argue it constituted a fine technical instrument. Here I challenge that interpretation and suggest that the German army of 1914-18 had structural weaknesses and conceptual shortcomings which inhibited innovation, distorted decision-making, and eventually helped destroy it. Some of those weaknesses were unique to the military, but others carried over from broader German society. Studying armies as institutions in their own right is interesting, but when, as in the two world wars, they are mass citizen forces, they open a window onto society as a whole which allows analysis of the military to take on wider significance. If historians have sometimes overlooked the operational art of the German army, the same cannot be said of the BEF, which has been studied under the finest of microscopes. One of the most influential and persistent myths in history, first sketched out by Winston Churchill and David Lloyd George, and enthusiastically developed and promulgated by Basil Liddell Hart and others, is that which sees the Western Front primarily in terms of British failure. The traditional narrative assumes that what went wrong on the Western Front did so because the generals were too stupid or the army too hidebound to adjust to the modern reality of barbed wire and the machine gun. The commemorations of the war's centenary have repeated the stereotypes encapsulated in Oh, What a Lovely War and Blackadder, more often than they have challenged them, showing how deeply seared into the public consciousness this myth is. The gulf between popular perceptions of the war and recent academic research has never been wider because, since the 1980s, a generation of British and Commonwealth military historians have been mining the archives to revise that traditional view. They have dissected almost every aspect of the BEF in minute detail and argued that its leaders were not, on the whole, fatheads and knaves who never learnt a thing. Instead, the British Army did remarkably well to overcome the immense challenges it faced and adapt to radical change in the most trying conditions, by marrying the best civilian expertise with military know-how to climb a metaphorical learning curve, until by 1918 it was capable of fighting the toughest army in the world toe-to-toe and beating it. The learning curve idea captures the central truth that the British Army of 1918 was certainly more effective than it had been even a year or two previously. It is not without problems, however, largely stemming from exploring the BEF in isolation without sufficient comparative research into the French and German armies. This is understandable given the mass of detail involved in the study of just one army, much less three, even before taking into account the language barrier. Nonetheless, this risks making British learning look exceptional. Also, it can exaggerate the British achievement by ascribing too much of the BEF's success to its learning curve and taking insufficient account of any deterioration in the German army. One of my core contentions here is that it is a mistake to see the war as a one-sided British struggle to learn a new way of fighting and break the stalemate. Although the front was deadlocked for much of the war, it was so only because there was a continuous dynamic of push and pull, measure and countermeasure between the two sides. This produced a deceptively stable equilibrium. This book argues that the battlefield defeat of the German army in 1918 was at least as much the result of the Germans getting worse as it was the British getting better. It therefore challenges us to revise our views of the BEF, which was neither a collection of butchers and bunglers, nor an institution made up exclusively of forward-thinking quick learners, but somewhere between the two. So Rupprecht's war enables us to see the war and the armies which fought it in a fresh way. It also prompts us to think again about the relationship between the First World War, modernity, and the agency of the individual. One of the things that first attracted me to Rupprecht was that he seemed to stand for a generation which was destroyed by the events of 1914-18. By the time the war finished, his eldest son and many of his friends were dead. He had lost his throne, and instead of leading a triumphant homecoming parade, he sneaked back into Bavaria incognito. The threat of trial for war crimes hung over his head for years. Never again would he enjoy true power or influence. Throughout the 1920s and 1930s, he watched as political violence convulsed his fatherland. Under Hitler, he lost his home, his family, and nearly his life. Like the cosmopolitan aristocrats of Central Europe so vividly evoked in Patrick Lee Fermor's travel books, Rupprecht can be seen as one of the many relics of a bygone age swept away by the tsunami of modernity. How far does such a romantic picture correspond to reality, though? Seeing Rupprecht as a victim fits neatly into popular perceptions of both the First World War and modernity itself. Most of us first encounter the war at school through poets such as Wilfred Owen and Siegfried Sassoon. The worm's eye view they offer inevitably drains meaning from the existence of the soldiers they depict. Unable to discern the larger patterns which make sense of their lives and deaths, of course the war seems bewildering and futile. These poets were keen to reject what they saw as the twee conservative pastoralism of Edwardian Britain, and so they eagerly highlighted the impersonal, the mechanical, and the modern in ways which have further influenced our view of the war. In Owen's poem, the Western Front is where, amid the monstrous clamour of modern industrial warfare, doomed youth are herded to their deaths with all the passivity of cattle. Similarly, it is a mark of the insignificance of the individual in All Quiet on the Western Front that the novel's ironic title derives from the official bulletin issued on the day its everyman hero dies. In other self-consciously modern depictions of the war, such as C.R.W. Nevinson's painting La Mitrailleuse, soldiers have lost their humanity altogether. Flesh and steel fuse into warfighting machines. The fact that we concentrate our commemorations today on memorials to those who were killed, not those who survived, only reinforces the victimhood motif. Also, to view the participants as victims rather than agents has the advantage of being psychologically easier on us. The victimhood we ascribe to the soldiers of the First World War is, therefore, multifaceted. It combines inevitable and pointless death with a sense of alienation from a modern world increasingly dominated by the machine, where humans have shrunk to insignificance and have no control over their own destiny. For all the efforts of some historians to correct it, this perception of the ordinary soldier as victim remains firmly dug in. Even if it is correct that the soldier in the trenches can be characterized as the victim of modern warfare par excellence, does that apply equally to all? Were there active subjects as well as passive objects on the First World War battlefield? To whom can we ascribe moral responsibility? Was Rupprecht entirely caught up by forces he could neither understand nor control? Did he conform to the romantic stereotype, or was what happened to him the consequence of his own decisions? The sources this book draws on are mostly new to an English-speaking audience. I have worked through a range of archival collections, primarily in Germany. First, Crown Prince Rupprecht kept a war diary, which is preserved in the Bavarian Household Privy Archive in Munich. It extends to 4,197 handwritten pages and was mainly put together as the war went on. There are two exceptions. He reconstructed the first few months of 1914 from notes over the following winter, and he also had to rewrite the last week of the war, having burnt the original pages before going on the run. This manuscript diary is full of detail not only about what was going on in his sector, but also about the wider war. The entry for a typical day, 1st of October 1917, for example, covers his tactical and logistical situation, one page, an intelligence report concerning a recent top-level Anglo-French meeting to discuss offensive plans, another page, diplomatic developments, one page, and the domestic situations in Britain, France, Russia, and the United States of America, nearly six pages. During the 1920s, Rupprecht's generalship in August and September 1914 attracted criticism in the early volumes of the German official history. The retired staff officers at the Reichsarchiv in Potsdam, who were compiling it, blamed errors he made for the failure of the Schlieffen Plan. To put his side in the long-running controversy which ensued, Rupprecht decided to publish a version of his diaries. He asked some of his former staff officers to read and check the manuscript, which was then edited down to a quarter of its original length and published in three volumes in 1929. Much of the material cut out was repetitive or, like the sometimes lengthy domestic and foreign press summaries Rupprecht used to write up, not relevant. On the whole, the published diary maintains the sense of the original closely, although on occasion Rupprecht was unable to resist tweaking it to make himself look better, as we shall see. He also toned down or left out completely some of his criticisms of individuals. Some historians have drawn on the published diary, but few have bothered with the manuscript version or with other unpublished papers, including Rupprecht's correspondence with his family, friends, and politicians. Another major source was the official records of the formations Rupprecht led, 6th Army and Army Group Crown Prince Rupprecht. These are held in the Bavarian State War Archive, also in Munich, and cover most aspects of both day-to-day operations and longer-range policy in considerable detail. They relate not only to Bavarian formations, but also to all those under his command, so they give us a broad view across the German army. The after-action reports compiled by units at all levels after battle, in an effort to learn lessons for next time, proved particularly valuable. These papers were supplemented by other official documents from the Federal Military Archives in Freiburg im Breisgau, where any surviving records from Potsdam are stored, along with other private papers belonging to Rupprecht's associates and subordinates. Published primary sources include the 14-volume German official history Der Weltkrieg, the Bavarian official history Die Bayern im Großen Kriege, 1914-1918, the series of battle monographs compiled by the Reichsarchiv between the wars, German regimental histories and officers' memoirs, and of course, the voluminous French and British official histories. This book is divided into five parts. The first four tell the story of Rupprecht's war from the beginning through to the end. Seeing the Western Front through German eyes in this way invites us to review existing, largely British, narratives of the battles fought there. We will discover, for instance, that battles which loom large in British military history sometimes hardly even feature as footnotes in the German equivalent. This also enables us to explore some of the broader themes already mentioned. Prominent among these is how the character of warfare evolved and the different armies adapted to change. Many chapters conclude with a section on this strand. Another recurring theme is the nature of command on the First World War battlefield. Such themes help explain both the war's outcome and the underlying strengths and weaknesses of the forces fighting it. The fifth and final part assesses Rupprecht as military commander and political actor and offers answers to some of the questions raised in this introduction. The war which emerges from this book is one of radical and dynamic change where the ability to outthink your enemy was just as important as being able to outmuscle him. It took both sides time and immense effort to adapt to the new ways of war, not least because every time they came close to an answer, the enemy changed the question. Eventually, however, the German army was dragged down by its inherent weaknesses and fell behind in the race to adapt. The results were disastrous. Sometimes Rupprecht and his colleagues were constrained in the choices they could make, but the decisions they took were nonetheless too often poor. The First World War was not just a war of bodies and a war of machines, it was a war of brains too. The Germans lost all three. Part 1. To War, 1914. 1. Rupprecht's Road to War. Prince Rupprecht Maria Luitpold Ferdinand was born in Munich shortly before 9 o'clock on the morning of the 18th of May 1869. He was the newest member of the Wittelsbachs, the dynasty which had ruled Bavaria for nearly 700 years. Rupprecht was the first of 13 children born to Prince Ludwig and his wife, the Habsburg Princess Maria Theresa. Rupprecht was related to most of the crowned heads of Catholic Europe, not only the Habsburgs but also the Braganzas, the House of Luxembourg, and even the Stuarts. Indeed, some saw his mother as the rightful Stuart heir, tracing her ancestry back to Charles I. When the Rupprecht visited London for Queen Victoria's Diamond Jubilee in 1897, members of the Jacobite Order of the White Rose tried to pay homage to him as the future King Robert I and IV. Rupprecht never took this claim seriously, but his very name had a Stuart link. King Charles I's nephew and famous cavalry commander during the English Civil War, Prince Rupert of the Rhine, was a Wittelsbach ancestor. Rupprecht was not born to the throne. The King of Bavaria in 1869 was his great-uncle, Ludwig II. Just 23 years old, he appeared perfectly vigorous, and there seemed no reason why he should not live long and build a family of his own. In fact, however, Ludwig's enthusiasms lay elsewhere. He was Richard Wagner's patron and was more interested in building fairy tale castles than in continuing the royal line. The towers of his castle at Neuschwanstein later inspired Walt Disney. Known as Mad King Ludwig, he died in murky circumstances in 1886, childless and unmarried. His brother Otto succeeded to the throne. Unfortunately, while there was room for doubt about Ludwig's mental health, there was none in Otto's case. He was indisputably insane. He had already been locked away for years and remained so until he eventually died in 1916. The uncle of Otto and Ludwig, and grandfather of Rupprecht, Prince Luitpold, became the real ruler of Bavaria as regent. When he died in 1912, Rupprecht's father took over, finally setting Otto aside and declaring himself King Ludwig III the next year. Thus, at the age of 44, Rupprecht became heir to the throne and acquired the title by which he was known for the rest of his life, Crown Prince of Bavaria. The throne which Rupprecht should one day inherit was a constitutional rather than absolute monarchy. The king was supposed to stand above politics and rule by consensus with his government and the two houses of the Bavarian parliament, the Landtag. In reality, he wielded considerable power. Although from 1906 the lower house was elected by universal male suffrage, the king dominated the upper house, appointed and dismissed the government at will, and dominated policy. The biggest constraint on Bavarian royal power was external rather than internal. In 1871, Bavaria became part of the new Imperial Germany. She was now just the second state among many, lying far behind Prussia in importance. Of the total German population, over 60% were Prussian, while only a little over 10% came from Bavaria. Prussia had the power to veto constitutional change on her own, whereas Bavaria could only do the same by building a broad coalition of the smaller states. That said, the government in Munich retained considerable powers and rights, including control over direct taxation. In peacetime, it remained responsible for raising and running its own army. Officers pledged allegiance to the Bavarian king rather than the German Kaiser. The army, however, was built on Prussian lines, and in the event of war, the Kaiser would become supreme warlord of all the German armies. Most crucially of all, the decision to declare war belonged to the Kaiser alone. The first half of Rupprecht's life saw dramatic change for all Germany, with rapid population growth, a rush to the cities, and huge industrial expansion. Bavaria was affected too, but differences in the patterns of growth and the development across the new country exacerbated pre-existing regional tensions. For example, although the population of Munich grew sixfold between 1850 and 1910, towns such as Essen in the Ruhr expanded more than 30 times over. Bavaria remained the least urban of the major German states and invested less in industry and scientific research. Overall, Bavaria could not match the pace of growth in the north. In 1870, the population of Bavaria had been 4.8 million. By 1910, it had increased by 40% to 6.9 million. This was huge growth in a short period, but remained well below the German average of 60%. Bavaria retained deep cultural roots in its agrarian past. 70% of the population was Catholic, with 28% Protestant. In Prussia, the religious proportions were almost exactly reversed. At the risk of generalization, Bavaria remained relatively agricultural, Catholic and conservative, even as Germany as a whole was becoming increasingly urban, Protestant and socially progressive. Even her conservatism, founded in the values of the smallholder farmer, was very different from the Junker and industrialist-dominated conservatism of the imperial ruling class. All these differences, new and old, created fault lines which divided Bavaria and Prussia. Even in peacetime, the relationship between the two was not always easy. Prussians tended to treat Bavarians with condescension, while the latter were prickly about anything which seemed to be eroding their rights and privileges. As we shall see, wartime only made these tensions worse. Rupprecht later complained that his childhood was a strict one, and to modern eyes his upbringing seems indeed to have been harsh. It is not clear that it was particularly so by the royal standards of the time, however. As a young child, he saw his parents only at mealtimes, had lessons daily from 8 a.m. until 5 p.m., and was frequently beaten both by his short-tempered father and by his tutor. In the finest tradition of German royalty, his relationship with his father remained difficult throughout his life. It is perhaps telling also that he reacted against the religious atmosphere of home in later life. At least as a young man, his Catholicism did not go much beyond observing the proprieties. At 13, he became the first member of the Bavarian royal family to be educated at a public school. He graduated from high school in 1886 and was commissioned into the regiment of foot guards. He later also spent time serving in artillery and cavalry regiments. He seems to have enjoyed to the full the relative freedom of life in the subaltern's mess, as well as the perks of being a young royal prince. Alongside his military duties, he spent several terms studying at universities in Munich and Berlin. He also began his public career. For instance, he attended Kaiser Wilhelm I's funeral in March 1888. When fully grown, Rupprecht was rather taller than average, at 5 feet 10 inches. He took immaculate care over his appearance and carried himself with the upright bearing of the natural athlete. In his youth, he had enjoyed swimming and skating and throughout his life remained a devotee of physical exercise and gymnastics. Well into middle age, he could sit down on the ground and get up again without using his hands or arms. He was a keen sportsman, in the old aristocratic sense, nothing so vulgar or English as team games for him. Instead, he enjoyed game birds and hunting, both in the Alps and abroad. In India, he killed a tiger from the back of a moving elephant with his second shot. Like most members of the upper classes of the time, he rode often. Even during wartime, a daily ride remained part of his exercise regime. In 1891, while serving in the 1st Heavy Cavalry Regiment, Rupprecht began going to lectures at the Bavarian War College, Kriegsakademie, where officers hoping to join the elite general staff underwent 3 years of intensive training. He attended some of the classes but was excused the strenuous exams. The aim, after all, was not to produce a professional staff officer, but to teach him command and leadership. In 1893, he was promoted to command a squadron as captain, Rittmeister. He rose rapidly through the ranks until in 1900 he was promoted to Major General, Generalmajor, in charge of the 7th Infantry Brigade at Bamberg. In 1904, as a Lieutenant General, Generalleutnant, he became General Officer Commanding, GOC, the 1st Division, and soon thereafter took over the 1st Bavarian Corps. He was promoted to full General, General de Infanterie, in 1906. He seems to have taken his military duties seriously and to have been a respected and able commander of men. Away from his military career, Rupprecht was well-travelled. Italy proved a special and enduring love. He went there almost every year of his adult life. He knew most of Europe well, but had also journeyed extensively around the Mediterranean and Middle East, Asia and America. He even wrote travel books. Some of his travel, of course, was for royal business. For example, in 1911 he attended the coronation of King George V, writing to an artist friend, "Time and again I admired the English race and its unique culture. The celebrations were great, but also absolutely exhausting. It is extraordinary how England is on the one hand so modern, yet on the other so exceedingly conservative. I wished you could see the coronation in Westminster Abbey with me. The picture was so artistic, a real symphony of colours." He was a man of culture and taste, although his reading was intense and critical, and he enjoyed music, but not Wagner, his passion was for art. He earned a reputation as a connoisseur, and many of his friends were artists or collectors. His first enthusiasm was for the Italian Renaissance, but he was a keen patron also of modern artists. His private life can only be described as tragic. After a playboy youth, Rupprecht decided that, once he passed his 30th birthday, it was time to settle down. In the course of 1899, he began to court his 20-year-old cousin, Marie Gabriele. She was receptive enough, but her parents were less convinced. When they sent her off on a trip to Verona and Florence with an aunt, Rupprecht pursued her. Travelling under a pseudonym, he somehow managed to get past the chaperone, proposed, and was accepted. After a furious family row, Rupprecht finally secured the approval of his father and grandfather, and the couple were married on the 10th of July 1900 in the court chapel of the Residenz, the old royal palace in Munich. As far as we can tell, the marriage seems to have been a love match. Of five babies, however, one was stillborn, and another two died in infancy. Marie Gabriele died in 1912, aged just 34. Rupprecht was left alone with their two boys and his career as a soldier. He threw himself into his work with redoubled energy. In 1913, he became a colonel general, Generaloberst, and commander designate of the largely Bavarian man's 6th Army in the event of war. On the 28th of June 1914, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir to the thrones of Austria-Hungary, was assassinated in Sarajevo. Since he had close family ties with members of the Bavarian royal family and had visited them only 2 months previously, the news came as a great shock in Munich. Over the weeks that followed, crisis mounted as the powers of Europe jostled for power and prestige. The Bavarian royal family and government played a passive role as onlookers. Although they had good contacts in both Berlin and Vienna and remained well informed throughout, they made no attempt to rein in Germany's reckless brinkmanship during the July crisis. The sympathies of King Ludwig III and his Austrian queen lay, unsurprisingly, with Vienna and Berlin, and in early July Bavaria intervened to block an attempt by the state of Württemberg to question the handling of the crisis in the Federal Upper House Foreign Affairs Committee. By the last week of July, passions were starting to run high across Europe. Outside the royal palace, crowds gathered to sing patriotic hymns and shout slogans against the Serbs and Russians. The royal family had to go out onto their balcony again and again to wave to the crowd. The atmosphere on the streets grew feverish. Enemy agents were rumoured to be poisoning the reservoirs. Air raids were expected any minute. Every woman in the street might be a cross-dressing spy. The mob harassed anyone who looked foreign or in any other way suspicious and threw stones through the windows of the Serbian consulate. When Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia on the 28th of July, the Munich mob cheered. The next day, all officers of the Bavarian army were ordered to return to their units. In this jittery environment, Rupprecht later noted, one was entirely aware of the seriousness of the situation, but also fully confident and believed that, given how things had turned out, it was best to appear utterly determined. At 5 o'clock in the afternoon of the 1st of August, 1914, Kaiser Wilhelm II sat down at his desk, carved ironically from the timbers of Nelson's victory. The Chancellor, Theobald von Bethmann-Hollweg, handed him the order that would mobilize the German army and set the world at war. The Kaiser and his advisers had discussed war time and again over the previous few days. The time for thinking and talking was now past. He did not consult Bavaria or other princely states. He did not need their agreement. The Kaiser was supreme warlord of their armies too. Wilhelm, with a flourish, signed the mobilization order. As soon as the news reached Munich, Ludwig III issued the proclamations which sent Bavarian soldiers scurrying to their depots to report for duty. Reservists returned to the colors, drew their equipment, and filled the ranks up to war establishment. Everything had been planned for and prepared, and within hours the first trains began to roll, carrying the army to the frontier. 2. The Battle of the Frontiers. Rupprecht set up 6 army headquarters in the luxurious surroundings of the Hotel Bayerischer Hof in Munich. His staff began to organize the myriad details involved in moving 220,000 men to war, working under the Chief of Staff Konrad Kraft von Dellmensingen. Ever since 1813, each field commander had been assigned a Chief of Staff. In theory, the division of labor between commander and Chief of Staff was clear. As one of the leading historians of the German army, Robert M. Citino, has put it, the chief of staff was not a co-commander, a surrogate commander, or even a vice commander. He was simply a highly trained officer who could give sound advice. The army or corps commander still had a great deal of leeway in deciding how to proceed. Although he was ultimately responsible for making the decision, a wise commander also listened carefully to the advice of his chief of staff. In practice, however, things were not always so simple. Conflicting views existed of the responsibilities of chief of staff and army commander. When the 33-year-old Crown Prince Wilhelm of Prussia was given command of 5th Army, for instance, the Kaiser told him to do whatever his chief of staff advised. The chief of the general staff, Helmut von Moltke the Younger, who was also present, hurried to correct the Kaiser. He told the young prince, "Never forget that the army commander is and remains the responsible head. The chief of staff has to advise, and now, God be with you." The relationship between army commander and chief of staff was ambiguous and fluid, and much depended on the personalities involved. Major General Konrad Kraft von Dellmensingen was 52 years old and the chief of the Bavarian general staff when he was sent to work alongside Rupprecht. This was a surprise appointment, the result of a mixture of politics and luck. Originally, the Prussian Lieutenant General Konstantin Schmidt von Knobelsdorf was penciled in as 6th Army Chief of Staff, with Kraft down to work with the Prussian Colonel General Eichhorn at 5th Army. Eichhorn, however, was not fit to take the field after a riding accident. Crown Prince Wilhelm was promoted to take his place despite his youth and inexperience. He had never commanded anything larger than a division. Clearly, he would need considerable support. Schmidt von Knobelsdorf was the obvious man to step in. Not only was he the most senior member of the general staff after Moltke, but he had been teaching Wilhelm tactics and operations at the Kriegsakademie and knew him well. Teaming Schmidt with Wilhelm would also avoid the awkwardness of the heir to the empire taking instructions from a Bavarian. So Moltke swapped Schmidt and Kraft over. Rupprecht was not only glad to have a Bavarian colleague, but knew Kraft personally from their time together at the Munich Kriegsakademie and respected him as a smart and energetic man. The two forged and maintained a close bond from the start. The next three most senior staff officers were also Bavarians, Rupprecht knew, the rest being a mix of Bavarians and Prussians. Indeed, 4 of the 5 army corps which comprised 6th Army were made up of Bavarian troops. The other was Prussian. Each corps fielded 2 divisions of about 18,000 men each. In addition, there was a Bavarian cavalry division, plus a brigade of older Landwehr troops to guard the lines of communication. Rupprecht's orders were to set up his headquarters in St. Avold, east of Metz in German Lorraine. He was to take overall command of the whole German left wing, including 7th Army to his south in Alsace. Under the famous Schlieffen Plan, designed by Moltke's predecessor, most of the German army would swing through Belgium and across northern France. Meanwhile, Rupprecht and the left flank were to tie down as many French troops as possible until the German right had outflanked and defeated them. In this way, Schlieffen and Moltke planned to knock France out of the war within weeks, freeing up troops to shift east against Russia. Specifically, the mission of the overall commander of the left wing is to advance towards the Moselle between Fouarde and the Meurthe, to tie down the French troops concentrated there and prevent them being transferred away to the French left wing. If the French, for their part, attack between Metz and the Vosges in superior strength, this mission may become impossible. In the case that it becomes necessary for the parts of our army in the Reichsland, Alsace-Lorraine, to withdraw, they should so direct their movements as to prevent the left flank of the main German forces being threatened. Should 6th and 7th armies not encounter superior French forces, then the possibility arises of operations by 6th Army, past Metz or to the south on the left bank of the Moselle. Rupprecht claimed in his diary that he knew neither his order of battle nor his mission until the deployment orders arrived on the 2nd of August. This may have been true in the very narrow sense that he may not have seen his specific orders in advance. It is less plausible that he knew nothing at all. The composition of 6th Army, its area of operations and its mission had all been fixed for nearly 10 years. Staff rides and war games had examined many aspects of the plan. Bavarian officers had been closely involved in exercises practicing operations in Lorraine. Even French intelligence had managed to obtain a copy of Germany's plans. It hardly seems likely that Rupprecht knew nothing, therefore. From later comments in his diary, where Rupprecht discusses deviations from the Schlieffen plan, he was clearly aware of its outline. He had also taken part in a mobilization exercise in Berlin in January 1914, where further intentions must have been discussed. In fact, during that exercise, Moltke specifically briefed Rupprecht on the most controversial aspect of the whole Schlieffen plan, the violation of Belgian neutrality. Rupprecht may have been playing down his foreknowledge to understate his involvement in an aggressive war plan which ultimately failed. The first few days of August saw a flurry of staff activity as the Bavarian War Ministry and 6th Army headquarters toiled to build up the army and get it moving. The peacetime strength of the Bavarian army was 4,089 officers and 83,125 other ranks. It suddenly expanded nearly five times to a total of nearly 416,000 men. Two-thirds of these constituted the field army, with the rest remaining in reserve at home. To deploy these men where they were supposed to go, the authorities commandeered some 5,500 locomotives and moved 285,000 carriages and wagons in the first 2 weeks of the war. We can begin to imagine the scale and complexity of the task facing Rupprecht's staff if we remember that a single army corps would occupy 140 trains or fill nearly 65 kilometers of road. Each corps required 130 tons of food and fodder per day just to survive. 6th Army had five such corps, as well as other attached units, all of whom had to get to the right place at the right time. While Kraft oversaw this administration, he also took the lead in drawing up detailed plans for the first campaign. He suggested that the best way to tie down the French would be to seize the initiative and go on the offensive, rather than wait for the enemy to move first. Rupprecht wholeheartedly agreed. The news that the British had joined the war worried Kraft little. "We'll easily deal with them too." Rupprecht was not so sure. "You don't know the English," he replied. Rupprecht found this period of preparation stressful and had trouble sleeping. The febrile atmosphere in Munich did not help. The weather was oppressively hot, and the nighttime streets were noisy, with crowds singing patriotic songs and hymns. He was relieved to be on the move at last when, in the evening of the 7th of August, he tucked his two sons up in bed, drove to the station, and boarded his train for the Western Front. Nearly 36 hours later, just before 8 in the morning of Sunday, the 9th of August, Rupprecht and his staff disembarked at St. Avold. A grimy industrial and garrison town some 50 kilometers east of Metz, it is today in France. In 1914, it was German in the part of Lorraine annexed in 1871 after the Franco-Prussian War. As he got down from his train, Rupprecht received news of the first casualties. Two German officers had cracked up and shot themselves. The war had already begun to extract its blood price. Of greater military significance were reports of early combat. Cavalry skirmishes along the border on the 5th to the 6th of August had been followed by a major French move down in Alsace. General Auguste Dubail's French First Army sent General Louis Bonneau across the border to seize Mulhouse. This Bonneau did on the 8th of August. French joy at this propaganda success was short-lived. The German 7th Army, under Colonel General Josias von Heringen, was responsible for the area from Strasbourg to the Swiss frontier. It soon bundled the French out again, and within 48 hours the French were back where they had begun. Bonneau became the first of many French generals in 1914 to be sacked by the commander-in-chief, General Joseph Joffre. On the 10th of August, Heringen formally came under Rupprecht's command. To delegate responsibility for the left wing to a local commander in this way was a sensible plan. Communications were expected to be difficult, which would make it hard for Moltke to control everything from Army Supreme Command, Oberste Heeresleitung, OHL. Telephones and radios were scarce and both were liable to interception. On the other hand, given the distances involved, face-to-face liaison was time-consuming and tricky. No formal command mechanism, such as a separate army group headquarters, had been planned for, however, and the whole arrangement was jury-rigged. Already stretched, 6th Army staff were simply expected to take on more work. Nor had the two headquarters practiced working together. Rupprecht thought this a fatal mistake. Although the two armies exchanged liaison officers, coordination remained poor. Strained relations between the commanders did not help. Rupprecht thought Heeringen extremely nervous. Heeringen, on the other hand, a decorated veteran of 1870 who had served as Prussian war minister and was nearly 20 years older than Rupprecht, felt that he was the senior of the two army commanders on the left wing and resented being subordinated. The use of a similar arrangement on the German right wing proved disastrous on the River Marne in September. Elements of 6th Army began to probe forwards. Near the border, sharp small-scale engagements took place at La Garde, 11th of August, and Badonvillers, 12th to the 13th August. The former was a neat combined arms fight where infantry, artillery and cavalry worked together well to take the village and nearly 1,500 prisoners. Losses, however, were heavy. At one point, about 1,000 Bavarian Uhlans charged, lances couched downhill and into the village. Cavalry on horseback immediately proved extremely vulnerable to modern rifle fire. Nearly a quarter of the men were lost. Badonvillers was a more confused affair. Here, combined arms cooperation broke down. The Bavarian foot guards, desperate to prove their courage, refused to wait for artillery support. Charging across 400 metres of open ground, the regiment lost 21 officers and 398 men to capture a town of little account. Rupprecht was angry at this bravado. How often during peacetime exercises did I tell people not to charge until much closer to the enemy? The main campaign opened on the 14th of August. In a thrust designed to synchronize with the first Russian offensive into East Prussia, the French 2nd and 1st armies, under Generals Noël de Castelnau and Auguste Dubail respectively, pushed across the frontier heading northeast towards Morhange and Sarrebourg. The French army is often criticized for tactical naivety in the early battles of 1914. The impression we have is of white-gloved officers deeply indoctrinated in the cult of the offensive, repeatedly leading red-trousered infantry forwards to ineluctable death, pitting fixed bayonets, heartbreaking élan, and flying tricolors against machine guns. There certainly were events like that. Two French infantry regiments were ripped to shreds by Bavarian firepower when they tried to capture the town of Cire with a bayonet charge across 2,000 meters of mainly open ground, for example. More generally, however, it was not the recklessness but the caution of the French attack which was remarkable. Despite generally only light opposition, Castelnau insisted on a methodical organization of the advance, with painstaking artillery preparation before any infantry assault. All ground taken was to be carefully consolidated in case of enemy counterattack. Meanwhile, the Germans withdrew as planned, hoping to suck the French forward into the trap. At first, the Germans thought the Lorraine attack marked the main enemy effort. Strategic intelligence suggested that as many as 18 of the 22 active corps in the French army were involved. Only after 3 days of combat did 6th Army correctly identify that the enemy was only half that strong. Collating intelligence in mobile warfare was never easy. Terrain and enemy cavalry got in the way, and it was often hard to tell the difference between active and reserve formations. These factors made it difficult to estimate the enemy's true strength. The Germans also had a problem of interpretation, however. They thought the Lorraine offensive was Joffre's main effort primarily because that was what they wanted to believe. The idea of a major French drive to regain Alsace and Lorraine played too neatly into what the Germans dreamt their enemy would do. The French were advancing so extremely slowly and methodically, only 5 to 8 kilometers per day, that 6th Army was beginning to think the chances of springing a trap were slight. The realization that they were facing only a subsidiary attack reinforced Rupprecht and Krapp's feeling that the best way to tie hostile forces in Lorraine was to attack, not defend. They had been pushing OHL to approve an offensive for days, but now they stepped up the pressure. In a series of telephone calls and face-to-face meetings between the 16th and 18th of August, with a shifting cast of OHL characters, including the Chief of Operations, Lieutenant Colonel Tuppen, the head of the political section, Lieutenant Colonel von Dom, and the Quartermaster General, Lieutenant General von Stein, Rupprecht pushed vehemently for permission to attack. He was growing frustrated at OHL not giving him a free hand to carry out his mission. One encounter with Dom on the 17th of August grew so heated that Dom forgot his sword and helmet in his hurry to get away. Finally, during the afternoon of the 18th of August, Kraft spoke again with Stein, who told him that OHL would not forbid an attack, that 6th Army must do what it considered right, and you must bear the responsibility. They decided that 6th and 7th armies would attack. The date they chose was the 20th of August. By the early morning of that day, the French had pushed up to 30 kilometers across the border. Dubai's men were in Sarrebourg, preparing to drive on the heights northeast of the town. Castelnau, buoyed by the apparent ease of his army's advance, discarded his earlier caution on the 18th of August and called for all possible vigor and speed and the energy and elan of all. Despite this encouragement, only Ferdinand Foch's 20th Corps, the famous Iron Corps, made much progress on the 19th of August. Crossing the plain of the River Say, they arrived in front of a steep bridge. On the heights above perched the small town of Morhange. Foch, despite orders from Castelnau to wait, decided to storm this ridge at 6 o'clock on the morning of the 20th of August. At 5 o'clock, as the sun rose blood-red above the ground haze, Foch's men began forming up. Suddenly, German shells from gun positions on the high ground rained down among them. Bavarian infantry swept down the slopes. "Our troops, in their enthusiasm, attacked with flags flying," wrote Rupprecht. Never again would they do so, but on the 20th of August, with surprise on their side, the Germans swept all before them. 20th Corps held up relatively well, but the rest of the French Second Army collapsed. Within just 90 minutes, the Bavarians swarmed across the valley and overran the French artillery lines. Further east, on the French First Army front, the pattern was slightly different. French morning attacks around Sarrebourg were shot to pieces by German defenders dug in on the hills, who then counterattacked in the afternoon. Here too the French fell back in disorder. Some French units lost half their strength. German losses were also heavy, however. One Bavarian division lost nearly half, 45% of its men. Within 48 hours, the French armies lost everything they had gained in nearly a week and were back where they had started on the 14th of August. Joffre had to shelve plans to transfer a corps from Nancy up to the north. The first major engagement of the war had resulted, as the French official history admitted, in a serious defeat. Moltke wept at the news of Ruprecht's success. The Kaiser awarded Ruprecht the Iron Cross, both second and first class. On the 22nd of August, the Germans won another major victory, crushing French forces in the Ardennes and adding to the general euphoria. Ruprecht and Kraft thought that they had done enough damage to the French that their mission in Alsace-Lorraine was complete. It was time now to stand pat there and send men north to join the main attack on the right. When Kraft suggested this to Tappen over the telephone in the afternoon of the 22nd of August, however, Tappen asked him to hold on the line while he went off to consult the chief of the general staff. When he came back, Moltke's answer was so surprising that Rupprecht later asked for it to be repeated in writing. Rather than redeploying northwards, 6th Army was to exploit success in the south with a drive on Epinal. They were to try and cut off the 120,000 to 150,000 Frenchmen still thought to be in the Vosges Mountains. Rupprecht was worried that such a move risked stretching 6th Army very thin and leaving its flank exposed to attack from Nancy. OHL had misjudged events on the German left flank. Communications had broken down in the hilly terrain and the French had retreated so fast that the Germans had lost contact. The situation was not as healthy as it seemed. The defence had buckled but not broken. Both French armies had caught their breath and reorganised, and they were now securely established behind tough defences along the imposing heights of the Grande Couronne de Nancy. From up there they could watch every move the Germans made on the broad plain below. The French also still held Fort Manonville behind the German lines. This blocked communications and only surrendered after several days of bombardment by monstrous Krupp 420mm howitzers. By that time, 6th Army was already tiring and the swing south had slowed. The French appeared to be slipping out of the trap in the Vosges. OHL, as always, pushed for greater speed, but Moltke seemed increasingly out of touch. Rupprecht complained in his diary that OHL underestimates the difficulties of the pursuit. The Kaiser thinks it sufficient to lead the cavalry through. A request to send troops to help Crown Prince Wilhelm's 5th Army west of Metz further irritated him. Not only was he already juggling several missions, but he felt Wilhelm was making his own difficulties by handling his forces poorly. It soon became impossible for Rupprecht to help Wilhelm in any event. In the early morning of the 25th of August, reports arrived of a major French attack out of Nancy into 6th Army's right wing. Here, the commander of 3rd Bavarian Corps, Lieutenant General Ludwig von Gibbsattel, had been ordered to sit on the defensive, well out of range of the French heavy guns in Nancy, and cover Ruprecht's flank. Gibbsattel, however, decided that the best way to execute his mission was to ignore his orders and attack. A series of savage encounter battles ensued. Gibbsattel's men advanced as if they were on manoeuvres with live ammunition. The full seriousness of the war had so far come home to few. By the evening of that day, some had certainly become acquainted with its full weight. French artillery fire overwhelmed the German attackers, who fell back in disarray. As rumours of the setback spread through the streets of Lunéville, panic broke out. Shots were fired and 19 civilians killed. In all, 70 houses were burnt down. A member of Rupprecht's staff, Major Rudolf von Zeilander, wrote that it is incredible how a victorious army can be reduced in so short a time to such a state by one single reverse. The nerves of our troops, who have been fighting bravely for several days without a break, are simply overstretched. It was not just the Germans who made battlefield mistakes that day. Men of General Emil Fayot's 70th Division attacked Hueville at 7 o'clock in the morning. Fayol described the result as a catastrophe. There had been no reconnaissance, no artillery preparation, and too many men were sent forwards in the battle line. 4,000 men were lost. It's crazy, he concluded. Nonetheless, as the day went on, the scale of the French threat grew. By the evening of a dramatic and critical day, during which Rupprecht had not been able to leave his operations room even for a moment, it seemed that this was another of Joffre's big pushes. At 9 o'clock, a liaison officer arrived from OHL with new orders to turn west and drive through the Charm Gap between Toul and Epinal. Rupprecht was now to join hands with 5th Army behind Toul. This unrealistic order was followed next morning by another. 6th Army was to attack the fortifications north and east of Nancy. This difficult task would require significant heavy artillery and thus take time to prepare. Rupprecht was getting increasingly frustrated. Despite the detailed reports we send them, OHL seems not to see the real picture and to be possessed by unfounded optimism. There was no way Rupprecht could execute these grandiose and conflicting orders. Instead, 6th and 7th Armies both went onto the defensive. The infantry of both sides had fought themselves to a standstill. The guns, however, still killed. French artillery observers seemed remarkably efficient. If even a single German was spotted in the open, shells rained around him. The only response was to dig. Trenches, dugouts, barbed wire, all the diabolical architecture that was to define the Western Front made its first appearance here in Lorraine. As yet it remained improvised and ad hoc, but already trench warfare had begun. 3. The end of the campaign in Lorraine. The first sign that something was wrong was a telegram from home late in the evening of the 26th of August. It told Rupprecht that his elder son, Luitpold, was seriously ill. The boy's condition deteriorated rapidly. At 1 o'clock the next afternoon, the doctors diagnosed the Swedish disease, polio. Little more than an hour later came the shattering news that Luitpold had died. He was just 13 years old. Rupprecht had now lost his whole family except for 9-year-old Albrecht. Even in an age more accustomed to children dying young than our own, and for a man with the stiffest of public upper lips, this was a cruel blow. Rupprecht tried to be stoic. There is no time to grieve, there's too much to do. Work is my consolation. He told his father that duty requires action, not grief. When Major General Karl von Wenninger saw him, however, he thought the poor man looked dreadful, crushed by the dual burden of news from home and the stress of the campaign. Luitpold was buried in Munich, with his father still far away. On the battlefield, both sides launched local attacks and the artillery continued to roar, but the front settled into an uneasy stalemate with little change in the overall situation. On the 1st of September, the French began withdrawing into their fortifications around Nancy, trading space for time and allowing Joffre to pull troops out and send them to his threatened northern flank. 7 divisions had left Alsace-Lorraine by the 2nd of September, some of them in time to take part in the Battle of the Marne. This was precisely what the Germans feared most. Although Oberste Heeresleitung, OHL, continued to press Rupprecht to keep attacking to forestall such a transfer, disagreement continued about how best to proceed. Poor intelligence and these disputes hindered decision-making. OHL wanted 6th Army to break through the Charme Gap and cross the River Moselle. Rupprecht, however, thought this impossible until Nancy had been neutralized, which would require siege guns and time to prepare. On the 30th of August, the Bavarian military representative at OHL, Wenninger, had just returned from a visit to Rupprecht when Moltke ambushed him as he walked into headquarters. "You were with 6th Army. When are they finally going to attack?" Moltke barked. Wenninger explained that enemy artillery fire was intense, losses had been heavy and the men were very tired. Some units had been in action constantly for 19 days. Moltke had no sympathy. "That's the same for the other armies too, yet they attack." In any case, he said, 6th Army's casualties were in many cases unnecessary. The units run into enemy artillery fire. That must cease. Moltke stalked back into his office, hardly waiting to hear Wenninger's reply. While Tuppen and Moltke continued to push for the drive into the Sham Gap, others at OHL took a different line. Major Max Bauer, for instance, the OHL heavy artillery expert, agreed that it was important to take Nancy first and promised to find siege guns to do so. 6th Army heard what it wanted to hear from the babble of voices and began work on plans for capturing Nancy. Kraft managed to overcome the nerves of his staff officers and corps commanders, reeling from casualties as high as 50% in just 2 weeks, and organize attack on the Grande Couronne for the night of the 4th, 5th of September. 6th Army hoped that a night attack would maximize surprise and reduce the impact of enemy firepower. Unfortunately, the sky was clear and the moon full, so the attackers were easy to spot. The experience of the 14th Bavarian Infantry Regiment, 5th Bavarian Infantry Division, attacking the village of Remereville, a dozen kilometers east of Nancy, was typical. Two battalions advanced an hour before midnight, each deployed with four companies abreast, covered by a few skirmishers. Meanwhile, artillery bombarded the village. After about an hour, with the attackers still 500 meters short of the buildings, the French detected them. The Bavarians tried to charge but were forced to the ground by heavy fire from well-dug-in defenders to the front and left flank, and the assault soon foundered. Attempts to clear the French from woods on the flank failed. Losses were mounting. Nearly all the officers were killed or wounded, and around 3 a.m., order broke down completely. Even when the Bavarians shelled the village with a couple of field guns firing over open sights, the situation remained dangerous. Further reinforcements in the shape of a battalion of light infantry, Jäger, did not help much, and the French finally evacuated the village only around noon. Casualties had been brutal. The Bavarians lost 750 men, or probably about half their strength, including the two commanding officers. The German attack on Nancy made little progress elsewhere either. OHL now seemed to be losing interest in Lorraine. On the 5th of September, Tuppen told Kraft to send two corps to the German right flank in the north. 6th Army had never thought its task easy, but now it seemed OHL was going to make it harder. Rupprecht and Kraft felt they were being hamstrung, but their protests were ignored. From OHL's perspective, the quick results hoped for had not materialized, and Moltke now had much bigger problems than Nancy or the amour-propre of the Bavarian Crown Prince. On the 5th of September, the Battle of the Marne began with a French drive into the extreme right flank of the German army, followed the next day by an offensive by over a million Entente soldiers from Verdun all the way to Paris. On the 9th of September, the Germans began to withdraw, only eventually stopping 60 kilometers back along the River Inn. Moltke's attempt to knock France out of the war with a single deadly blow had failed. The situation on the Marne and the increasing difficulties of Crown Prince Wilhelm around Verdun threatened to draw further resources away from 6th Army. When Rupprecht was told to give up further ammunition and divisions, he drove at once to OHL in Luxembourg to complain. There he met Moltke, who impressed me as a sick, broken man. His tall body was hunched and he seemed extremely haggard. The whole interview struck Rupprecht as surreal. Moltke went on to say things I didn't properly understand. He spoke of a new mission for me and stared at me wide-eyed. To Rupprecht's surprise, Moltke agreed that the attack on Nancy could continue after all, on condition that the heavy guns be given up in a week at most. Surprise soon turned to even greater confusion, however. Even while Rupprecht had been motoring to Luxembourg that morning, an OHL staff officer arrived at 6th Army bearing new written instructions. All forces in Alsace-Lorraine were to go on the defensive. Active formations were to disengage, reorganize, and prepare to be moved by train to northern France, leaving the front held by second-class units. This was the new mission Moltke had spoken so cryptically about. He probably had not realized that Rupprecht knew nothing of it. When 6th Army asked whether it was to follow the verbal instructions to attack or the written ones to disengage, it finally received an unambiguous and clear answer. The latter. On the 10th of September, Rupprecht's men began pulling out of the front line. 3 days later, the first men left for Belgium. On the 17th of September, Rupprecht handed over the Lorraine command to General von Falkenhausen, who established a defense line more or less along the old frontier. And there, for the next 4 years, the front line sat. Losses on both sides had been heavy. Of every 8 German soldiers who arrived in Lorraine at the beginning of the war, approximately 3 became casualties and 1 died. In frontline combat infantry, who bore the brunt of the fighting, the proportion of casualties was inevitably higher.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.